already. This was flying in 2022. This is going to a metal asteroid, which has, which might be a failed core of a planet in our solar system. And this is a very golden opportunity to see a failed core. And because there's no way we can go to our core, it's just impossibly hard to do that. So SciTech Mission is actually a partnership of three different institutions. ASU, which is where the three leading principal investigator is from, Mindy Atkins. The second is SSL, Space Systems Dora. They're up in Palo Alto. They're helping us design the spacecraft structure and the electric propulsion system and the solar arrays, which on the side, you can see that. And JPL, which is managing the mission and developing the software, the telecom systems, the laser comm system. This one has a laser comm system. And a bunch of other things like software and guidance algorithms and stuff. So why 16 Psyche? Why this planet, this asteroid? So this was discovered back in 17th of March, 1852, in Naples. This is the largest M-type asteroid. It's like a Star Trek terminology, M-type. It's metal-type asteroid that we know of. We have been to places which have rocks, even water. We have never been to a metal world. This is really the first metal world to visit. And this is really fascinating because we actually don't even know how it exists. And there are theories now saying that this might be actually a failed planet core. So this is a golden opportunity to see how the planet core looks like. And that's one of the hypotheses we'll be testing. How big is Psyche? It can fit between Flagstaff and Phoenix. It's almost the size of the massive Jupiter. So it's not huge. So, and that makes it harder. It's harder to orbit a body which is small, because the gravity is very ill-defined. So you need to do constant correction on your orbit and trajectories. And where does Psyche lie? It's beyond Mars in the main asteroid belt, between Jupiter and Mars. It's, the maximum distance Psyche achieves is 3.33 AU, and the lowest is 2.75 AU. And the idea is to get to Psyche, we can't use traditional propulsion, because it's very hard to slow down, because it doesn't have a gravity well, like you talked about. You need gravity to slow down as well. So we use something called electric propulsion to reach Psyche. And that's one of the things we work on at JPL is electric propulsion trajectories and electric propulsion missions. So this is how the mission will look like. We will launch from Earth in 2022, August, tentatively. And then we'll do a flyby of Mars, which will help us get enough energy to go and get captured at Psyche. And after that, we'll have 21 months of science operations at Psyche. We'll do four different orbits. A big one and a small and three small ones coming all the way down to 70 kilometers of Psyche, which is, and after that, if we have fuel left, which we probably will, because generally NASA missions last way longer than they're supposed to, so we'll end up staying at Psyche for a long time and then finally crashing on Psyche. And these are the three main science goals. I won't go there, but it'll be very cool to actually visit this world, because this is literally, we have no idea what we will see. This is purely an exploration mission. And because of exploration, we don't have any good idea what science payload to carry, what instruments to carry to study it. So we're carrying all kinds of stuff. We're carrying magnetometers, neutron spectrometers will tell us what stuff it has, and some imagers can do imaging in different spectrum. So we'll definitely get very cool images for sure. And because we need electric thrusters, we have started testing these thrusters. This is an actual electric thruster firing in a vacuum chamber. And this blue dust is xenon ions coming out. And the force from this thruster is equal to a force of a hand from a small napkin. That's all it feels to the spacecraft. But it's continuous over many years. So it builds up, and it builds up very quickly. And it's way more powerful in the end than a chemical propulsion, which is like, hey, just do it and done. And the concept I showed you before on solar gravity lens cannot use this, because we need to have a lot of change in velocity immediately close to the sun. So for that concept, we need chemical propulsion. But for Psyche, we need to slowly get to Psyche in 4 years. So this one is perfect. And this allows you to reduce your propellant uses by a factor of 10. So you need 10 times this propellant. That means a smaller spacecraft, cheaper spacecraft, something NASA can do. So in the end, it all comes down to cost. And this is part of electricity, which is also easy, because we have huge solar arrays now. And just to give you a small idea on the whole mission, how it works, we launched from Cape Canaveral. In 2022, we deploy our solar arrays, huge ones, on each of them size of a big football court. Electric propulsion thrusting happens for like a few years. We do deep space optical comm. So we have this cool technology demonstration we're doing on the mission, we have this laser which is pointing at Earth and sending data back just by switching on and off at very, very high frequency. And it gets really hard to point at Earth from these huge distances with very fine accuracy. So the laser is basically has a maglev system. It floats and then it points automatically to Earth because it, the spacecraft cannot guarantee that much accuracy. So it is very technology savvy mission in terms of optical communication, but it's not required for the mission success. It's just a demo for now. And this is something we want to use in the future because this will enable us to transmit 100 times more data down to Earth than the normal radio communication allows us to do. So the bandwidth is huge on laser com. Then we do a mass gathering assist, and then we finally go to Psyche, and we start operating it for the next 22 months. So just to give you a small, cool overview how the mission will look like when we need Psyche, we made a small, nice, funny, interesting-looking video how it looks like. This is how the space will achieve. This is our understanding of how Psyche should look like. We have no really no idea right now, but hopefully it will look like this. So and this will be in 2026 when we reach Psyche, and it might be the actual core of our exoplanet planet that will help us learn about our planet and all other planets which have been forming our solar system for many, many years. So this video is just showing, you know, it's just a cool video from ASU. So I just thought it would be good to put it here. Yeah. And we do expect it to have different coloration like this too. But we can't guarantee that because we have no idea in essence. And this is in two scales, so you can see how the spacecraft looks like when it's flying over. And it might have these weird shapes and geometry on this because it's primarily metal. So and it formed from condensation after many volcanic events. So yeah, I mean that's all I have on Psyche, and I'm very glad to be working on this. Since I was very small, it was my dream to work on an actual mission going to space, and now finally I am working on that one. So I'm pretty happy with this. With this mission, but I'm hoping to work on the solar gravity lens one as I go forward. So with that, I'm done. Thank you very much. I'll take questions if you have any. I'm sure you have many.
Sure. How did you choose Psyche over the tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of asteroids that are out there?
That's a good question. Psyche is the biggest metal asteroid we have. And you know, visit a metal asteroid. So the science team put together a case. So there were 21 missions which were proposed to NASA in the last Discovery round. This is a Discovery class mission. And each Discovery class mission is up to $500 million in cost. So this is cost cap. We are given a cap of the cost, fit the mission in this cost. So we have to figure out the most exciting mission in that cost. And the PI of this mission, she was very good at communicating that message across that this is the next step for NASA in terms of exploration. So, and given that we have never visited a metal asteroid, this is the first of its kind mission. So it's a real mission of exploration. And that is what Discovery Concept really wants to look at, a real mission of exploration. So that's how we came up with this. So I'll go into that part.
How are you going to get that? The pictures back, it's 550 AU.
Very good question. You saw the deep space optical comm system we are testing on Psyche?
The laser?
Yeah. So we will use the big telescope for the solar gravity lens also as an optical comm system. So interestingly, it's very easy to use that as an optical comm system as well. So we just put a small laser a diode inside the in the telescope and it shoots the huge laser back to Earth. And we did calculations. We will need a small beacon between Jupiter and Mars, which will help us triangulate our position to Earth. Otherwise, it's from that far distance, it's very hard to point at Earth properly. Yeah. So we need a beacon which helps us point to Earth properly. But once we have that, it'll be okay.
Watts? Is it going to be? I mean, it's going to be measured in watts or?
So we did a calculation as well. If we have RTGs, which are radio isotope thermoelectric generators, that's how the rovers are powered on Mars. They're basically nuclear fuel being just there, and we use the heat produced from the fuel to actually power the spacecraft. If we have three of them, we get like 900 watts approximately. And out of that, if you pump 700 watts to the laser, that will, yeah, you know what? The watt, the current laser we are testing on Psyche pumps 145 watts to the laser. And that is barely enough to get any good data rate from Psyche, which is 3.63 AU. Imagine 550 AU. So we need 900 watts. And then we can get like, I don't know, 100 bits per second data rate, which is very low, but it is enough. So we calculate, it'll take us 5 years to get all the data down. But that's okay. At least you get something, you know. With RF, it's just impossible because you can't get a pointing, and you need too much power with RF. So it's another challenge, but it is still engineering. You can engineer it still. Yes.
So I wasn't understanding so it just heads out on a straight trajectory.
Yeah. So what happens is
a line?
Yeah. So that's a very good question. You need to know the exoplanet you want to look at.
You have one target.
Yes. So that's why I said once we discover Earth 2.0, only then this mission makes sense. This is not a mission for exploration. That mission will be a mission for characterization. It will characterize that one target. So that's why all these other telescopes are needed, like JWST. Find that one golden target for this mission to look at. Once we know that target, then this mission makes sense. Otherwise, we don't know where to look at. And because you have to basically go in the opposite direction of the exoplanet behind the sun, there's only one target. In reality, you can call it a tool, but it's hard because you have to be very finely pointed to get that exoplanet.
So it has some amount of time where it can look at it, and the sun keeps getting smaller.
Yeah. So after 550 AU, all the way up to 6000 AU. So there's a lot of time once we reach solar gravity to get the exoplanet imaging. So that's not an issue. We looked at that.
What's the angular accuracy that you got to maintain in order to image on a planet?
I have no idea. It's probably very fine. I have no idea because we did not do a very good GNC analysis on this. We were just limited by how much time we had to work on this. And we just wanted to see if it's even possible. Mm-hmm. And now we are actually entering the next phase of the concept, and our major thrust is to get that hydrogen system working close to the sun. So we are trying to do some tests up at NASA Ames. Maybe in the next 2 years, like get a small hydrogen system with a heat shield, see if the heat exchanger actually works and you can get the fuel through it. Because we have never used this kind of propulsion system before. It's a new, novel propulsion system which can only be used when you have a heat source very close to you. So it's kind of a one-off.
How hot is the gas going to be when you heat it up?
So it's probably on the order of 4 to 5,000 Kelvin. Oh, centigrade, yeah. It's really hot. I don't remember that terms, but I can check it up in like 5 minutes and tell you. It becomes really hot. And it reaches a point that the material of the nozzle starts melting.
Yeah.
So we need to not have that hot gas. But the problem is if you make the gas cool, we don't get enough thrust.
Yeah.
So it's a trade, and we are right now just close to the point that it's not hot enough to boil us. But there will be trade-offs and a lot of design studies once this gets into the next level of detail. Right now it's on the concept of like, hey, is this possible? Up or down? So.
What is our redundancy in your communication?
In terms from which one, Psyche or?
You're a single thread. If your laser dies, you're dead.
That's true.
You're not gonna have two of them.
Yeah, that's true too. We will have multiple laser emitters inside the telescope. So we can have multiple of those behind each other and we can switch them back and forth. That's one way. And we still want to carry a radio antenna, a deployable radio antenna. We still want to carry one. We will just get a very, very low carrier signal, like 1 bit per second. And you will be like waiting forever to get any data down. So it'll just be like telling you, am I alive or am I dead? It'll give you like a tone, say, hey, I'm alive. That's all you can probably get. Because even from voices right now, it takes us more than a day to get anything down. Like we send a signal, it takes 1.5 days to get to Voyager. Because of lifetime. Your lifetime limited. And that is one thing you can't cheat. So the spacecraft has to be fairly autonomous. So there is a small effort at JPL going on into building autonomy into our spacecraft. You'll be surprised how dumb our spacecraft are. Like you think it's all cool, it's rocket science. The spacecraft are pretty dumb. Anything bad happens, they point back to it and say, hey, I don't know what to do, tell me how to fix it. So it's called fault protection. And the fault protection systems right now, we have a very, they're pretty sophisticated in terms of the logic, but they're not very autonomous. And that's something we are building towards, but it takes time and money for those things to happen. So we don't have a huge amount of money. We are at 0.5% of GDP, so it takes time for all things to happen.
This is a rare all-metal or mostly metallic asteroid. What are most asteroids made of?
It's a very good question. They're mostly made of, I'm not a scientist, should I answer this?
Carbon, silver, carbon?
Yeah, yeah. They're made of like silicates and like, as I understand, like rubble. Like some asteroids are like kind of like very rubberless. You come close to them, they can disintegrate. Some of them are made of rocks. But they are not, metal asteroids are rare. We only have found 19 of them in our local asteroid belt. And this is the biggest one. So basically we don't really understand this very well. And any meteorites we ever gotten back to Earth did not have any of these signatures. So these are very rare quantity of entities out there.
Is it as big as Ceres?
No, it's, no. Ceres is 2,300 something kilometers.
Oh.
In diameter. This is like 200. This is much smaller than Vesta even. But this is the biggest one we've ever found. And so it'll be a fairly big challenge of orbiting this thing. So we are trying to design orbits which can like stay stable. Because they get unstable very quickly. You do a small wrong maneuver and start getting unstable. So you need to like design orbits which are like fairly stable by going into highly inclined orbital dynamics.
Maybe you'd get a better orbit if you had a huge magnet inside your
If so, the thing is, that's maybe true, but then the issue is we don't know if the asteroid has a magnetic field yet. We are carrying magnetometers to check that. We assume it'll have a very big magnetic field because it might be a failed core, but it might not. So we cannot guarantee that and cannot rely on that.
How hackable is your communication channel? Because some of the people have asked, and they haven't really considered that. I mean, that's an issue.
This is a very good question. So yesterday, in one of the meetings, we were talking about this, and somebody was asking, so have you thought about this? There was a review going on.
Yeah.
And we were like, yeah, we just started to think about this now. So
yeah.
This has not been a huge issue for missions in the past, but now there's a big active a group at JPL looking into, at least at JPL looking into, like, you know, can we hack? How do we survive hacking? But I mean, we assume naively who would care. But now we have a laser system on board.
Yeah, it's
It's not a very powerful laser system, but people will still freak out because it's a laser system.
Security isn't a very good security.
Yeah. So we are they have they are active. There's active going on JPL.
Yeah.
Make sure things are not happening.
One person can destroy the whole effort, you know?
They could, I mean, theoretically, yeah.
And so there are people who would, right?
But the spacecraft software is built in with fault protection, and the fault protection is very robust. It will not ever do anything bad to the spacecraft. It has multiple checks and balances, and it will stop even you from doing something to harm the spacecraft, and it will ask you 10 times before anything bad happens. So theoretically, yes, you can harm the spacecraft, but it is a very hard job.
You could point it at the wrong place, and you could change its orbit.
Yeah, if you do that, any of that, it will know you're doing something wrong. It will shoot it off, switch off, come back to Earth, and it will start talking
about that. I guess that's my point. I think it's important. I guess I've worked in security long enough.
I agree completely. And
you never imagine people would do this, but if it's imaginable, they do it.
Yeah. No, I agree with you, and there are people working on it. And actually, I was surprised to find it out myself.
Yeah.
In this case, distance is your friend. Unless you know where it is, you're going to have a very narrow beam talking to it. But they don't know where it is. They've got a spot of the sky.
Exactly. Actually, for the optical communications, it's a huge challenge on the spacecraft to point it back to Earth properly. And not even Earth, it needs to point at California. There are two ground stations which are optically receivers. One is in Palomar, and one is Optal. And they both have to... It has to point fairly accurately, and the unit vectors to point them are, right now we're just defining those things. We don't actually have a very good sense of that.
I'm talking about the uplink. In other words,
the uplink is also a challenge. But that's just a demo. That's just a technology demo, the optical communications, because we need to figure all this out. And this Psyche is the guinea pig mission for testing this technology. But once we do it, we got, we have done this once in space station. We had a mission already called Opals, which tested the optical comm system down from lower orbit. But that's a different ballgame than doing it from 3AU.
Is there any other propulsion systems that could put a spacecraft out there to Voyager very quickly, like nuclear propulsion or ion? Or?
So we looked at all of that. We looked at nuclear thermal propulsion. So we use nuclear power to heat up hydrogen and throw it at high velocities. The problem, and we have nuclear electric propulsion, where instead of solar power, you use nuclear power to use a low thrust system like I showed you in Hall with xenon gas. The first one, nuclear thermal, the issue is it gets too heavy right now. The technology we have is too heavy. We didn't have enough investment into this for the past many years, so we never advanced the technology enough. It's very heavy right on the system itself. So if you want this much thrust, you need to carry this huge system. So in the end, it's like a chasing game. You want thrust, you want big system, you want more fuel, then you want more bigger engine. You end up with a huge system which does not give you the right performance in the end. So you end up with this effect of the bowling ball effect. You keep on adding more and more and more fuel. You get the velocity you want, and you can theoretically calculate the maximum limit of delta V, change in velocity, you can ever achieve with the current technology is like 7 kilometers per second on the spacecraft using nuclear thermal propulsion. And it'll cost you more too. With the solar thermal propulsion, this is what we are calling this new system, solar thermal propulsion, that can achieve up to 15 kilometers per second delta V, so it's twice. And that it's a factor of 2 in velocity, but it's a factor of 1,000 in actual spacecraft energy, because every extra delta V you put when you're close to the sun amplifies. So it's an exponential addition to the exit velocity. So that's why I think the solar thermal propulsion is a very exciting idea, but it's only useful when you have enough heat. So it can only be used in some places in the solar system, and sun being the prime place where you can use it. Any other questions?
Would it be possible to send, from this focus line, an optical message or whatever to the exoplanet?
Very good. That's completely true. There are a few scientists who already looked into that. Like I said, basically, when you go to the solar gravity lens, there might be already extraterrestrial civilizations sending messages using their suns, and they might be talking to each other in this way. We just have never encountered it because we don't know how to use it yet. And they might all be using their suns and other stars for an intergalactic communication network. And that was actually one of the ways they were proposing on doing telecom from other stars. We eventually get to the star, we'll have these daisy chain of multiple stars all connected to each other through the lensing effects, and having terminals, receiving and sending terminals at their focal lens. So you can daisy chain a big system like that for communication.
Somebody using the black hole at the center of our galaxy, you don't get light off of that, and it's much bigger.
That's true. But I don't know what the lens point for that, or lens line for that.
So you'll have to figure it out. I'll leave that to the next
question. Yeah. This is probably a little too hard for me. I'm only 5 years in.
Well, if there are no more questions for our speaker, I will. So, coming in, SBAU Mug.
Oh.